Hello everyone, this is the lecture to accompany Chapter 4 in your textbook. I highly recommend that you carefully read Chapter 4 because there's a lot of information in it that I simply don't have time to talk about in this lecture. All right, let's talk about interpersonal perception. So what is interpersonal perception? Perception is the process of making meaning based on the things that we experience in the environment. We're always trying to make sense of what happens around us. So our brains are constantly coming to conclusions based on our senses. In other words, the stimuli that's coming into our brains. And we're filtering that through our frame of reference, which is our previous experiences, our assumptions and beliefs about the world. So the meanings that we create might be very accurate, they might be somewhat accurate, or they might be very inaccurate, and it's all about perception. There are three stages in the perception process. Now, these things happen so quickly that we're usually unaware of them, but today we're going to break perception down into three stages. Selection, which is where your brain decides what to pay attention to. Organization, where it classifies that information, and interpretation, where, based on all those things, it reaches some kind of conclusion. Let's start with selection. In the selection process, that begins with the stimulation of our senses. So something attracts our attention. Things are happening around us all the time, and we can't pay attention to everything. That's where selection comes in. Now, it may or may not be a conscious decision about what we pay attention to. Usually it's not. However, some things might stand out more than others. If there's something unusual or unexpected, then our attention goes straight to that. If it's something that happens repeatedly, we are more likely to notice it. If it's something that's more intense than other things, it's louder, smellier, brighter, or something like that. And if it's something that we are specifically told or we specifically choose to focus on. Now, if you did the selective attention test before watching this lecture, you know what I'm talking about, because if you're told to pay attention to something, then you may miss something else going on around it. As in the case of that video, it would be the gorilla walking through these people passing a basketball around. And you may or may not have noticed that because you were paying attention to something else. The next step is where your brain classifies the stimulus. Now, our brains need order. Even if you think your brain isn't particularly orderly, it truly is. It starts trying to figure out where the stimulus fits in with all the other experiences and knowledge that you possess. This is called a perceptual schema, or your framework for organizing information, and is usually classified into one of these four groups: physical constructs, role constructs, interaction constructs, and psychological constructs. So physical constructs are objective characteristics, things that you see that you can quantify, like how big or small something is. In the case of a person, this would be what they look like, how tall they are, their body shape, what their hair color is, that kind of thing. The second thing is role constructs, and this is where you categorize by role or professional position. We notice where this person falls in society. Then there are interaction constructs, so we notice the behaviors of this person. Are they moving around a lot, aggressive, or seeming to hold back? How do they act? That's something else that we are paying attention to. And finally, psychological constructs. We notice thoughts and feelings that this person seems to be portraying, such as anger, shyness, or hesitation. And finally, interpretation. Our brains need to figure out exactly what all this information means. This is where you actually come to conclusions. So your conclusion might be, wow, she's really mad, or oh, she's trying to get me to do something for her, or she's letting me know she likes me. So that is likely going to be based on three factors. The first factor is your personal experience. So you go through your brain and you interpret things based on similar experiences that you've had. In similar situations, what has been the outcome of that? Another thing that can play into your interpretation is your knowledge of that person. So what other experiences you have had with this particular person can help you come to a conclusion. And finally, your relationship with that person, in other words, how close you are to that person, will help you to establish meaning. Now, the perception process is not always linear. You know, it doesn't necessarily go specifically from one step to the next to the next. It happens so fast and instantaneously that we don't even really stop to think about it. So what influences our accuracy? Well, sometimes we're generally accurate in our perceptions. Sometimes we're right on the mark with those perceptions. Sometimes we're completely inaccurate. So we're obviously perceptive enough to make it through the day. However, we're just as often widely off the mark. And why is that? Well, three main reasons. Physiological states and traits. So our feelings, our emotional state, our physical state, and our temperament can influence the way that you perceive things. So if you're tired or hungry or upset, you may respond differently than if you're awake and happy and comfortable. Another thing is your culture or co-culture, and the differences between cultures can definitely influence the way that we view others. For instance, let's take the monochronic versus polychronic cultures. In a monochronic culture, such as America, time is very important, so it's critical that you be on time, and if you are a person who's on time, that works in your favor. Whereas if you're from a polychronic culture and you come into American culture and time is not that important to you, then if you are continually late for your job, your boss may think that you're lazy or you don't care, but that may not be the case. But that is the perception of your boss based on their culture. And finally, social roles. Social roles are sets of behaviors that are expected of people in a particular situation. For example, if a man is your boss and he's straightforward, uncompromising, and he doesn't take less than the best from his employees, he might be perceived as powerful. However, if your boss is a woman with those same characteristics, well, she might be perceived as, pardon my French, but a bitch. That's because females are often still associated with a particular set of behaviors because of the traditional social role of women in our society. So we think we know what's going on around us, but frankly, we are often vulnerable to certain forces that shape our perception. So let's look at these things that can get in the way of truly seeing what's going on. Stereotyping, we've talked about it before. It's classifying people based on their group membership. Now, while making generalizations about a group based on observations and measurements, it's part of the scientific process. When you start applying those generalizations to individual members of the group, then you've crossed over into stereotyping. Now, it may not be possible to completely avoid stereotyping because those things are often automatic in our brain. However, you can be more aware of your tendency to make assumptions about people based on their group affiliation and realize that those perceptions may not be accurate. Of course, through more interpersonal communication with somebody, you might find that your initial perceptions were wrong or maybe even right, because sometimes the stereotype does apply to an individual, but not always, so you have to keep that in mind. The primacy effect governs our first impressions. Sometimes the first thing we notice about a person is often the most important in our perception of that person. So once our impression of that person is formed, it's often difficult to change that impression. It can be done, but it takes effort and time. For instance, I have a very dear friend that when I first met him, I didn't really like him. There were a couple of things that I perceived about him that really colored my impression of him, and my impression of him was negative. Now, he's a dear friend, but it took time to get to know him better before I realized that that first impression was not necessarily the case. Just as first impressions are important, the most recent impression is important too. That's the recency effect. It doesn't necessarily contradict the primacy effect, but if you put them together, they show the importance of the first and most recent impression. Our perceptual set limits what we perceive. Now, our perceptual set is our ideas about the world, what we use when we go through the perception process. So we have a predisposition to perceive only what we want to or what we expect to perceive. And our experience and our expectations that spring from that experience causes us to see things in a particular way. So that perceptual set is influenced by everything that we've experienced in our lives. Our ethnicity, our sex and gender roles, our cultural experiences, and our personal experiences all play into that. And it limits us to seeing what we want to see. Now, egocentrism, if you break that down, ego means self, and centrism means centered, basically. So egocentrism is self-centeredness, and that tends to narrow our perspective. Now, obviously, every child goes through that egocentric stage, and the great majority of us never truly get over that. We still have some level of egocentrism, although it's less than when we were a toddler. But we do tend to see things from our own perspective. And, you know, one of the first things that our brain asks us is, how does this affect me? Whether or not you still think it's all about you, you really do think that sometimes. And sometimes it's difficult to see from any other place. So that can get in the way of looking at things from somebody else's perspective. And then there are the positivity and negativity biases. Positivity bias is the tendency we have to view information about a person in an overly idealistic way. Negativity bias is the opposite, the tendency to view information about a person in an overly negative or pessimistic way. So focusing on either the positive or negative aspects of a person when you're forming an impression about them can influence our communication and eventually our satisfaction in long-term relationships. For instance, very attractive people are often viewed by other people because we have this positivity bias towards attractiveness that we may also imbue or endow this person with other positive characteristics that they may or may not have. So we have to consider that when we're making impressions of people. Another example of a positivity bias is a woman who is in a violent relationship but won't leave because she just knows that underneath this guy is a really good man. And maybe he has some positive characteristics that she's focusing on so that she doesn't have to deal with the negative part of that person. And the negativity bias is where you have a negative opinion of someone and even positive information about that person will not change your mind because you're focusing more on the negative opinion that you have of that person. So we explain behavior through attributions. Why did something occur? Why was my employee late for work? Well, attributions have three elements: the locus, the stability, and controllability. So locus is the location of the cause. Is it an internal cause within that person, or is it external outside that person's control? So if it's internal, maybe my employee overslept. Maybe it's external. Maybe my employee had a flat tire. The stability. Is it permanent or semi-permanent? Was the cause something that can always or sometimes happen? For instance, traffic is always bad in the morning. So maybe that's something that happens a lot. And is it controllable? Was the cause under that person's control? If they overslept, then that would have been under that person's control. But if there was a big accident on the freeway, then that was not under that person's control. So we usually use these things in combination with each other, and we try our best to come up with an accurate explanation for the behavior, but we're not always accurate. Sometimes we're totally wrong. And that's because of something called attribution error. Attribution errors are often referred to as mental shortcuts. We may not have all the facts, but we come to a conclusion anyway, based on what we think and what we know. So we combine those two things together, even if we don't know everything, and come to a conclusion anyway. So I'm going to point out three common attribution errors. And the first one is called a self-serving bias. And that's our tendency to attribute our own successes to internal sources and our failures to external causes. So we attribute our own successes to stable internal causes and our failures to unstable external causes. So if something happens good in our lives, then that's due to me and my own efforts, whereas any failure in my life is due to some kind of outside force that I don't have any control over. It's a natural thing to think, but it's often delusional. Then there's the fundamental attribution error, in which we often attribute other people's behavior to internal causes, rather than attribute someone's positive or negative behavior to external causes. We attribute them to the person's character. We attribute the good or bad tendencies of other people entirely to internal causes. In other words, their character. But of course, everyone's behavior is at least sometimes a response to an external force. And then over-attribution, and that's the tendency to attribute many behaviors to one or two characteristics of a person. So if somebody happens to be an only child, then you know, everything they do, you go, well, she's an only child, so what do you expect? So now that we know just how much we actually suck at perception, who knew that just attempting to make accurate sense out of the world around us would be such hard work? How can we improve our ability to perceive others more accurately? Well, what I try to do is recognize that the truth, with a capital T, does not reside in my head. It doesn't reside in your head. It doesn't reside in anybody's head. So we have to truly be mindful of our perceptions, because perceptions are not necessarily truth. Be aware that perceptions are just perceptions. They are not reality, but often they are what we use to judge people. So you should know yourself. Know yourself and your own biases. Think of how your perceptions are influenced by your personal attributes, by your gender, by your group membership, by your psychological and physical state at any given time. It may be impossible for you to, if you're a woman, think like a man, if you're a man, think like a woman in a particular situation and see if you perceive it differently, but at least you can become more aware of how who you are affects the way you see things. Another thing you can do is to focus on other people's characteristics. Try to see if your perception of someone's behavior is based on who they are and what your natural reaction is to that person, and see if that's coloring your perception of what's going on. And by that I'm talking about group membership, like gender or culture or other characteristics of a person. Then you need to consider the context of the communication, the environment in which that behavior occurred, the way you experienced that behavior. That all plays a part in your perception. Remember, our perception is selective and we can't perceive everything about any given communication. Something else we need to do is check our perceptions for accuracy. How do we do that? Well, we separate interpretations from facts. Sadly, most of us accept our interpretations as fact, but that may not be the case. Much of the time, our facts are completely subjective, so keep that in mind. You might want to generate alternative perceptions. Try to come up with other explanations for a person's behavior. How much do you really know about this person? How much do you really know about this situation? Maybe what you think happened and what actually happened are two entirely different things. Engage in perception-checking behaviors. Ask yourself if you could be wrong. If so, you could directly ask through questions or indirectly find out through listening and observations, and be okay with revising your perceptions as necessary. Most of us hate being wrong. Many of us stick to our perceptions stubbornly just so we won't have to admit we're wrong. But nobody learns anything that way. That completes the lecture on Chapter 4.